engaged in manufacturing of industrial and medical gases, LED lighting, aluminium pressure die casting in Punjab and Himachal Pradesh. Presently, he is member of managing committee PhD chamber at national level and mentor of Punjab State chapter. Over to you, sir.
Okay, thank you, Ramneet, for the very encouraging introduction. My heartiest welcome to all who are attending today's seminar. This is a very informative and knowledgeable subject. This is quality management, design, and standardization. First of all, I would like to welcome all of you on behalf of PhD Chamber of Commerce and on my own behalf. And I would like to take the opportunity to heartfelt gratitude to Mr. Gaurav Sharma, who is technical expert GIS, and with two very eminent speakers, Mr. Naresh Chawla, very well known to all industry all over here in the region. He's senior consultant, Kaizen Institute India. And Mr. Ankur Teer, principal consultant and trainer, Quality Solutions, Chandigarh. Friends, we are very much thankful to you on today's presence on today's events. I would like to briefly tell about PhD Chamber to you. The chamber, which was established in 1905, is a very proactive national apex chamber, which works at the grassroots level with strong national and international linkages. Chamber acts as a catalyst in the promotion of industry, trade, and entrepreneurship through its research-based policy, advocacy, role positivity for the economic growth and development of the nation as well as commerce. We are organizing many events time to time, and this is part of the, we have just started few months back this MSME innovation with the partnership of GIS. Chamber has 130,000 companies at its member, directly or indirectly, and we have signed around more than 100 MOUs with different chambers, embassies, and the country level international associations. We operate with 60 plus sectoral expert committees. Our key thrust areas are industrial development, health, education, skill development, housing and infrastructure, agri and agribusinesses, and digital India. At global level, we are working with the embassies and high commissions and to bring the international best practices and opportunities for our members. I'm happy to share that this GIS MSME Innovation, which is a series of events we are organizing for our selected members, which we are providing technical support for and identifying the challenges and issue being faced by them in their business model related to marketing, technology, productivity, compliance to quality standards, and offering relevant solutions for the growth under this project. We have already organized sales, marketing, and IPR interventions. Today, with our two experts and members of this select committee, we will be giving the knowledge of through our speakers on the quality management, process design, standardization steps to improve the productivity and employee morale. Friends, use of QMS tools of process design and standardization definitely decreases ambiguity, guarantee quality, and it improves the productivity. It ensures compliance with regulations and provisions of products and services in the most cost. With this, I would request our eminent speakers to cover 7 principles of quality of design, need of standardization and use of standards from improving quality and achieving customer satisfaction, introduction of QMS and product process standards applicable to manufacture, covering Indian and global outlook. I'm sure these 2 experts will definitely give much knowledge which is required to all our team members. And I would like to have the presence of Ma'am Madhu Pillai. She's director, regional director of PhD Chamber at Chandigarh. And of course, everyone knows Ramneet, who is heading Punjab chapter. All the best. And over to Ramneet. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, for your welcome address. Now, I would like to call upon Mr. Naresh Chawla. He is Senior Consultant, Kaizen Institute, India. He is Business Excellence Coach with over 25 years of experience in driving innovation, continuous improvement, and performance excellence in different organizations. He is a Certified Productivity Practitioner from Asian Productivity Organization, Japan. His key interest is in improving the competitiveness of the supply chains and business organizations through quality improvement, cost reduction, and faster delivery mechanisms. Using pertinent practices such as TQM, Lean, Six Sigma, and Industry 4.0. And today he'll be covering, types of design, 7 principles of design, what are the challenges for industry with respect to design differential in this challenging times. So over to Mr. Chawla. Sir, you need to unmute.
Thank you, Ramneet. Thanks to Mr. Sajdeva, Madam Madhu, and PAD Chambers for providing me this opportunity to interact with the galaxy of people. That too on a subject which is very, very close to my heart, and I always feel very passionate when I talk about this subject. And this subject, it is again, it's a part of the national priority which you are having. I generally say on every forum that there are 2 national priority which India is having. The first priority is that we have to give job to the people, and for that we have to focus on entrepreneurship. And the second, the priority which we are having is that we have to reduce our trade deficit. We have to have more export and less import. And what good thing is there that in the last few years, we have seen that the export has increased, but still, if you see the trade deficit, it is almost $15 million and a very long way to go. And this can happen only if we improve the competitiveness of our product. And that can only be done through the concepts like the total quality management is there, or the lean is there. And we have to improve the operational excellence so that we can have a better quality, less cost, and faster deliveries are possible. So these are the priorities which you're having. And this subject is very much linked to these priorities. I'm very happy that PAT Chamber is doing a good job in this regard. So coming to my presentation now, I will share my screen with you so that we will talk more, and I will show less to you, but still some presentation I have made. The quality management and design and standardization. We all know this formula that if you spend 1 rupee or $1 at design stage, it will save your 10 rupee in the execution and 100 rupees when you launch. So I think everybody has understood this. Now, only thing is that how to make this happen? What are the different tools, what are the different approach we can use so that we can improve our design, we can test our design. And for that, I would like to explain this, you can say how the buying happens. Because our design has to match with the buying behavior of the people, that how people buy a product. Okay, so I will just try to explain this with one example. Say you are, imagine that you are going to buy a vehicle. You want to buy a car. So buying a car about score a century or a quarter century ago was a different thing, but now it's an altogether different thing, especially in a city like Chandigarh, where public transport is not very good. So we all have our individual preferences. So first of all, we have to see that I have to buy it for myself or for my wife or for my kid. Okay. And if it is for myself, then I am going to take a loan, or the company is sponsoring, or my wife is working or not. So all those things will be there, that for which person you have to buy the car. And the second thing which I will decide is my budget, of course, means that how much money I can spend. Maybe if I'm buying with myself, I will say, okay, I will go for a 10 lakh plus vehicle. Okay. If I am buying for my kid, I will say, okay, 5 to 6 lakh range is there. So that's how I will decide my budget. So once I will decide my budget, after that, I will see that what type of, you can say, features I am looking for. What type of car I'm looking for means I am going for a compact car or a sedan or a SUV, and what kind of features it should have. It should have safety features, balloons, okay, or means what sort of top speed it should have. So all these things I will decide, what type of tires I should have. Okay, so what should the color it should have. So all these things you will decide, and then you will decide about the quality. So quality, I'm using it in a very broader way. I want to say the reliability of the product, or the branding of that product, means you want to buy Honda, you want to buy Ciaz, means the different vehicles are there, so different brands are there, so you will buy all those things. Our product is launched in a similar fashion. The first thing is that we have to see that what customer segment I am going to cater. Right now we are having a different segments are there. So accordingly, I have to design my product, whether it is going to, you can say, for the males, females, okay, working, non-working. So there could be n number of categories which you can make. So the first thing is capturing the voice of customer. And then I will decide my cost, target costing I have to do, because your costing has to match with what the price your customer can give. That is very, very important. And then you will decide that based on the customer segment, what type of features you have to introduce into your product. And after that, you will decide the quality parameters and how good those features should be. But apart from this, there is another factor which is contributing very high, especially in these days. As I was telling you that 20, 30 years back, things are different. But right now, our mindset has become an e-mindset. So the speed is highly essential. So if a customer is going to showroom and he wants to take some product, if it is not available, he will not wait for you. He will just move on, or he will go for some other, you can say, brand. Days are gone means I remember I got my Chetak. I waited for 3 years, but now those things are not possible. Customer wants instant things. And we also must have seen, means whenever we are going to launch some product, we are having a design ready, we are looking for investors, or we are looking for money, and suddenly we are finding that product is already available in the market. So it doesn't mean that somebody has stolen our idea, because that idea was already there in the air. But only thing is that somebody has invested, you can say, in the design, and they have shown that much speed that the product is already available in the market. So there are two, you can say, challenges, or the things which will distinguish your product in these days is your speed and your quality. And these things you have to build in your products. And when I'm saying that you have to build in your product, so there's a whole journey is there, that what sort of product quality you are looking for, what sort of process quality you are looking for, then innovation quality is there. Yeah. And then we talk about the organization quality, or sometimes we refer it as a culture. So assuming that this forum is of MSME people, so I will say our culture will be like a startup culture. Okay, so the more focus in such scenario is on innovation quality. That how you can say you are deciding your parameter and how you are quality by design, your prototyping, capability development, all these things are very, very important for any MSME. Right, so this thing is very important. That's why it means we are focusing more on design. And then design, after designing, we have to go for standardization, because standardization will give you speed. Design, appropriate design will help you in capturing the right kind of, you can say, customer voice, then deciding the right kind of features. And then with standardization, you can say, go for multiplication of that product, and that can happen only through standardization. Right. And we also know that most of the accidents which we have seen in the past, they can be attributed to the human errors. But almost all the cases, the human errors are because of, you can say, the result of the poor design. So there are a number of cases on Google. You can search it. Just one example I will share with you. There was very famous car. The Ford Pinto was there, which was launched in 70s. It was famous because it was the first car which was launched with the price tag of less than $2,000. The same thing which I told you, because you first have to decide your costing, that it was for the masses. Price tag was less than 2,000, and then they reduced the weight also to have more performance, that it should be less than 2,000 pounds. Okay. And that is how means this has taken place. But there was some problem. There was some flaw in the design. What they did, that they put the oil tank just behind the axle. So what was happening, that whenever somebody was hitting the back, there was a great chance that there will be an accident or there was a fire. Right. So there were a lot of fire incidents which were happening, and there were a lot of lawsuits were there, and this car was withdrawn. And later on, this design was changed, something like this, so that it can be made safer. And this incident, you know, it led to the use of a very famous tool which we are using right now, that is FMEA, failure mode and effect analysis. And FMEA was not new thing for them also at that time. It was already used by the military. It was already used by NASA. It was already used by the Boeing. But it came to automobile industry with this incident, that whenever we are going for a new design or a change in design, we should assess that what are the risks associated with that, and we should start having a risk-free design. And apart from this, there were a lot of tools, and most of those tools, they have come from Japanese, you can say. The first thing, this FMEA tool, this is a pure American tool. But apart from this, whatever tool has come, they have come from Japan. So one tool which is very much related to this is your, this FMEA we already covered, that is your quality function deployment. So in quality function deployment, you know, we first see the customer requirement, what is the voice of customer, then those voice of customers are translated into the product features. And accordingly, you know, there is a cascading. You know, the customer requirements are translated to design requirement, to design requirement, engineering design is there. Okay, then the manufacturing and purchasing requirement was there. So that is how this tool was invented. It was used in Japan. And then there was another tool which was, which is still in use, that is a Kano model. Kano model is a, it came later, but it is a very basic tool. And many a times, whenever we are assessing the voice of customer, we are trying to see, whenever we are having our features, that whether this feature is a delighter, or it is giving the performance, or it's a must be feature. So all the features we are trying to categorize into three categories. Delighter is something which is a customer want, but it is not a need. It's not a need. So we are just trying to excite our customer with that feature. Performance is something for which the customer is paying. Customer is coming to us for that particular features, and must be features are the those features which he is not stating, but those are implied things which has to be there. Right, we'll take one example. Say automobile is there. So I remember when I got my first car in 99, at that time, AutoCop was a delighter. Means if you are buying a car and you are getting an AutoCop with that, it was a delighter. Otherwise, it was not there. And after some time, I have seen that if you are buying a car and you are getting a music system along with the car, it was a delighter. But now all these things with the technology and the changes in the customer preference, these delighters are getting change into performance and must be need. The best example is a mobile. When the first time we used a mobile, the objective was only to make a call. That is the performance which you are expecting from any mobile, that we can uninterruptedly call somebody. But then there was the first delighter that came was, I remember the Sony, the Sony 105, it was a colored mobile. It was a delighter. People used to show that I'm having a colored mobile. And then came the camera. Okay, right now, if you talk, nobody talks about the camera. We talk about how many cameras you are having or how many pixels you are having. So all delighters has come to a must be need. So this, I have to see, you can say, with the changes in the technology and with the changes in the preferences of the consumer, how my features are moving. If there is any problem in the must be feature, my product will not stand for a day in the market, right? So for those complaints or for those things, I have to attend immediately, even for performance related complaints also, right? So this was, you can say broadly, you can say quality planning tools are there, which we are using whenever we are going to design. But the problem with design is that it is not something which we start with the, you can say, some feature in mind. We have to first assess the voice of customer. That is very, very important. So empathic, we need to be empathic. So that is why the concept of design thinking has come up, and we are trying to incorporate those principles into that. And before that, I will just tell you that what type of designs we are having. Broadly, there are four type of designs are there. The industrial designs are there, interaction design are there, experience design are there, and the emotional design are there. So you have to see that what type of customer you are catering. Industrial design means it's a B2B. So whenever it is a B2B, the material is very, very important, because your customer is a learned customer. He is already aware of your product. So he will understand that what type of material you're using, what type of processes you are following. So that is a industrial design. So right now, the interaction designs are increasing. Interaction design means when you where the person has to interact with the product, where the person has to communicate with the product. Say I'm driving a car, so I'm communicating with my steering, I'm communicating with my horn, right? How these things are placed. So that is very, very important. I can tell you my experience when I was learning, scooter the first time. So I kicked it, and because I was having some idea of cycling, so it was not very, time consuming for me to learn how to drive scooter, but I was not aware that where the horn is. So the person who was teaching me, he told that, okay, just press your thumb. So instinctively, I just pressed my thumb and horn was there. So means in interactive design, we will see that how the human will behave. That's the best position where you can put the horn. Even if you are not aware, the first time when you will try to press a horn, your thumb will automatically go there. Then the experience design is there. Sometimes people say that what's the difference between interaction design and experience design. The main difference is, first I will share what is the common thing. The common thing is ergonomics, which I told you, that how the human behave, that is something which is common between interaction and experience design. But the interaction design, it's focused on that particular moment only, how I'm using that product. But experience design, you know, it will take care of the whole journey. Means even after using that product, how I'm feeling. So that is why it means these days, the experience design is becoming very, very popular. And in the last, we are having emotional design. Emotional design means where I'm trying to say, for example, sometimes we are designing certain products only for children because we know that what kind of emotions they are having. We are trying to have some product only for the girls. Okay. Sometimes we see something, we say that it's a girlish. Why we say girlish? Because the emotion which that product is giving is of a girl, right? So those designs are also becoming popular, but I will focus mainly on interaction and experience design, right? So let's see that what kind of our principles are there. Before this, what are the steps in designing? I already told you that previously we used to have define, ideate, prototype, and testing. These were the standard design parameters were there, steps were there, but now one step has been entered, that is you need to empathize first. So your design has to be human-centered, how the human behave. Yes, so we will just take one example. Say you are making sanitizer you are making. So the first thing you have to see that whether your product is for a home or for a marketplace. So if you are for making for a home use, so you can make a simple sanitizer where the bottle is hanging and the person has to press it. But this design may not work when you are using it for at marketplace. So for that, what you need something like a foot operator. You need that somebody should come and it can be operated with the foot. And at certain places where, you know, the type of people are different, or you are giving it to say schools or the colleges with the heights are different. So there may be a need that it should be adjustable. So that could be one need which people may have. Okay, so I will discuss along with this. And there are 7 principles which we were talking about of designs are there, which are getting very, very popular these days. Rather, there are 6 principles. And using these 6 principles, you should have your conceptual model. So the first thing is the discoverability. As I was telling you that your feature should be discoverable in your product. I'm not sure how many times you have faced this problem, but I remember in early 2000, whenever I used to go to some hotel, there used to be some problem for locating me in the different controls of my washroom, different controls of the shower. And it was not due to only the product design fault. Sometimes the installation was different. So this is something means will be of interest to the people that how the control should look like so that the person who is using it, he should be able to recognize, he should be able to discover that control immediately without any problem. And now we are also having sensor based, these fittings are there, but now how to put my hand? So sometimes it is not clear. So we are struggling sometimes that where I should put my hand. The best example of discoverability I can give you is the Google. If you open a Google, so you know that where to type. So that is a discoverability which I want to highlight. And another thing in discoverability is there are if you enter into any room. Okay, so what happens that we try to, we pull it, okay. But whenever there is a fire, so instinctively we don't pull a door, we push a door. Whenever we are under panic, we push a door. So that is why now I think it is a regulatory requirement also that all your fire exit, it should have a push operation. because that is our natural instinct. We push, and we should have a long handlebar instead of having a small handle, which we are generally having on our doors. It should have a complete bar, so wherever I'm pressing, I should be able to open that. So this is one example of discoverability, depending upon the human need, how humans are behaving. I'm sure that the most of the people in Chandigarh, they must have gone to Elante. So in Elante, if you have observed, there was one lift, one escalator near the lift, where, you know, whenever you are going, you can say up, it was on the right side and coming down on the left side. So it was causing a bit confusion. So later on, it was changed because, you know, whenever there is a fire, because we are in India, we keep left. So you will run to your left side. So if you run to your left side, and if the operation, desired operation is not there, so if you want to go up, it should be on your left side. If you want to go down, it should be on your left side. So that lift is now swept. I have seen, somebody must have pointed out. So this is also, it's a you can say our instinct, cultural instinct, because we are keeping left. Then there is a principle of affordance, that your product should tell that what is desired from that. So if you see a knob, you know that I have to rotate it. And there are, you can say, written 1, 2, 3. So you need that. 1 means less pressure, 2 means more pressure. Okay. So you see the scissors. This is the best example. You know that where to put your finger, where to put your thumb. So it is giving you an idea. So if you see a chair, you see that, yes, it is for sitting, then how to sit there. Okay, if the back is there, then how I will sit. If it's a stool, how I will sit. So this thing has to be there in your design. Your design should tell that what object has to perform. Okay, the quality or a property of an object that defines the possible use, or it makes clear how it can be used. This is called affordance. And you know, we can also use signifier. Signifier means you just see this, you can say you're opening your vehicle. Okay, so if you're having a button, the button is giving you an affordance. It is telling that this is something where you have to press. Okay, but now you are also putting, you can say, sign on that. Okay, if it is, you can say, for unlocking, it should be like this. For locking, it should be like this. Okay, so I am signifying my affordance. So that is also possible when you are designing your product. Mapping is very, very important. Many a times, if you have to use instruction manual to use any product, it means that product is designed very, very shabbily. So you are, you can say, product, whether it's a washing machine or a refrigerator or a cooking stove is there, it should tell that how to operate. So you can see two figures. In the first figure, the mapping is very poor. We don't know that which knob is for which stove. But in the second, you can see definitely that which knob is for what. Okay, so that mapping can be done. This you can see in the lift, you can see in your lot many software programs are there. You can see all this mapping, which is very, very essential. This is just one example that if you have a plain sanitizer, you can say, and the handle or paddle is there, but you don't know where to put it. So you can also signify, or you can map it, that where to put your foot. Okay, so this is one example. This is another example that how you can make it for kids. Means you are putting the emotional content over there. Some odd creature is there at the foot, and you know, there is a instinctively we like to kill those things with the foot. So that is how you can say promote use of sanitizer for the kids, right? And similarly, you can see that in the first one, you don't know where to put your hand, okay? But in second, you know, you can say some signifier is there, that where to put your hand and how this will operate. all these things you can see when you are defining your product. And then, you know, there are certain products where feedback is required for the action. Say you are pressing some button. Okay, so some click is there, so you know that, okay, I have pressed this button. Or some light is there, some glow is there. So if you are going to push this, okay, if the light is there, so it means the action is complete, right? So so that is how the use of feedback is done. This you can see in every appliances. If the appliance is on condition, then there will be different light. The best example is your water geyser is there. Okay, so if the green light is there, it has different meaning. If red light is there, it has a different meaning. So it is giving you a feedback. That feedback could be audio, it could be visual, it could be verbal, and it could be tactile, means with some touch you can know what type of feedback is there. And then you can put some constraints also. Constraints means what your product should not do. It is the inverse of your affordance. The best example I can give you of your USB drives. Okay, so if you're trying to put it on the reverse condition, it will not go because it is meant to go in a different fashion. Similarly, the scissor, I'm telling you, it is a constraint. If you want to put you can say four fingers where the thumb has to go, you will not be able to put. So that is a constraint. So this also you can see that this is like a mistake proofing, you can say. Something like mistake proofing, that the your gadget should not be used in a wrong way. So that is how we use this function. So these are all the six principles of designer there, and based on this, then we are coming up with our prototype, right? So best example you can see is the dashboard of any vehicle, and after that you have to go for standardization. Means if it is a left hand drive is there, okay, so every vehicle will be something similar to this. You cannot have a steering position different than this. ABC is there, okay, accelerator, brake, and clutch is there. So this is also defined in a particular fashion, and that has been standardized. The brake will always be on your right side. It cannot be on left side, because when you are putting a pressure to the left side, you cannot control your mind. Your pressure will not be controlled. So that is why many times I have seen the people who are having automated vehicles where only two pedals are there. Okay, so accelerated is there or brake is there. So both the things you have to operate with your right leg. So if you are trying to operate your brake with the left leg, you will feel a problem. You will accidentally put pressure, and there will be complete jam of your operations. Right. So all these things have been taken into care, and some reasonable standardization has been done so that the people should not get surprised when they are using that kind of vehicles. Right, so this was all about these design principles which we can incorporate in our offering whenever we are designing our product. Right, so if you have any question, any query, we can take up right now or later whenever the schedule is.
The queries we can take up towards the end of the session and during our interactive session.
Okay, sure. Right, so thank you very much. The major learning which I want to give through this session is that, first of all, we have to capture the voice of customer. That is very, very important. And depending upon the voice of customer, we have to decide the broad category of our design. And after that, we have to be empathetic that how the person is going to change or use my product. Apple is the best example. Nobody has told Steve Jobs that you have to, design a smartphone. But he just tried to see that how the people will feel happy to use that mobile. And that is how that design has come. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, for your very detailed and informative presentation. The quality function deployment, which you discussed, then Kano model, steps in designing, principles of design, mapping. I'm sure our industry members, they will get benefit from the inputs shared by you. So moving further, now I request Mr. Ankur Dheer. He is Principal Consultant and Trainer Quality Solutions. And he has over 18 years of experience in providing services in the area of PQM, ISO standards, product and process certification, zero effect, zero defect. And he is empaneled lean consultant with National Productivity Council and also Z Master Trainer with Quality Council of India. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, ma'am. Good afternoon to everyone. I would like to thank PhD Chamber, Ramneet ma'am, Madhu ma'am, Shri Sasdeva, and Shri, my previous speaker, Mr. Naresh Chawla, who gave you insight into the design thinking part. Now, I take you to the journey of standardization. Now, imagine if your support staff, mean any person who is entering your factory, he has no set guidelines for handling a ticket, or we can say a process or product failure, to handle bad quality at least. So how you actually work? Generally, in a setup, if we don't know anything, randomly, we ask them to set up a help desk. There's always a help desk which looks after all the activities. And these activities tell us what are the, generally we look at in a factory environment, we just generally look at some charts, some instructions, some set of activities being carried out. And mostly the MSMEs, they try to figure out what are the things which are getting us to issue. Now you struggle like this. This gentleman is trying to complete or remove any, handle a ticket or a process properly, but he doesn't know how to handle this. So he has some complaints. He doesn't understand. He doesn't have a proper induction. So that's the gap which generally the MSME have in working with organizations. Now, generally what we see, we look at standardize the processes. What are the standardized processes? Generally the processes your operation, your company is doing, like it is a daily operation or a weekly operation or a monthly operation, there is always a gap that how to run these activities smoothly and standardized. So basically we look at what is the requirement, how the customer orders, what are the process requirement, what are the tasks we have to carry out, the activities we generally work, we define the scope, we define what are the quality methods or methods we need to follow to implement so that we can standardize our rules, so that we can have better visual controls, so that we reduce human error. The bottom line is, to improve quality, we need to reduce human errors, which we try to improve by using standardization. Now, standardization doesn't happen in, say, like servers telling you about how the standardization came. Now, you do a voice of customer. Based on voice of customer, you did a QFD, right? The QFD, basically, why we are doing a QFD? We are doing QFD because we have to standardize our core processes. Now, all processes, there would be variations. How we handle those variations? What are the access points of these variations? How are we going to change that? And how we are going to use that knowledge which is available to us via forums like PhD Chamber or any other forum where we are members, we share with each other, we get to know what are the things which are in and what are the things which are not in. Now, why we do use standardization? Just to introduce a more simplified process, improvement culture, so that we can participate equally in global as well as local level to manufacture products which achieve the requirements of my customers at the global level. Now,
I have a query. I would like to.
So we'll be taking queries, you know, after this presentation.
Actually, this is not quite relevant to my industry. Could you please add some examples for the manufacturing sector also, food manufacturing also? so that we can understand better. Actually, we are not dealing directly with the customer also, and we are not into customer support. That's why I am raising the query. Thanks.
Sir, I request you to, I will take your concerns, sir. We'll take your concerns. But right now, let us go through that and then we'll address your questions, right? Right. So I was talking about why standardization, because introducing, this is a simplified process. Now we have to understand that how we can customize our process and remain competitive. That's the need why we need standardization, as was told earlier by the previous speaker, it about quality function deployment. Now quality, why we need quality function deployment? Because quality must be designed into your product, not inspected into. Quality can be meeting customer needs, providing superior value. Now, how we can add quality into our products? By we have to replace customer needs and emphasis, as told by the six design principles. We have to look at a method for developing these design quality parameters into our products and processes. Now, we have to translate those demands by VOCs, voice of customers. Then our quality assurance teams can design our production phase where they can increase our productivity throughput, which we call throughput, through comprehensive customer satisfaction needs. Now, this is a systematic way to define this. That is known as standardization. Now, as told, we are going for product planning, we are doing for assembly part, we are doing process planning. Even in food industry, we are doing this product planning, deployment, we are doing process planning. We're doing quality control activities, which we call it HACCP activities, hazard access and critical control points, which we discuss to define what are the customer needs. So we understand, trying to understand the customer needs, then we identify what are the critical areas or assemblies we need to manufacture, what are the do's and don'ts. Then we define the process flows. We determine the part and process characteristics in a QFD approach. Now, here comes the standard needs. Now, standards is the process of creating protocol so that we can create a good or a service base, which is actually gives you consensus to all the relevant parties in the industry that this is how a product should look like. Like as sir was giving an example about a phone, the main function of the phone is that it should be good for communication. What camera it is, what is the basic function requirement would be how well the communication gets through, whether it's an audio or a video call, what is the transmission and how well it performs that duty. The other things, there are several apps in the phone now, they are internet enabled phones. So the standard keep on updating itself, but the specific requirement of that would be the voice quality and the audio quality of that phone must be good. So that's one we are looking at standardization. Now, standardization also has been ensuring the safety and interoperability or compatibility of the goods produced. So whatever we produce should be able to be sold to the customers. Now, some of the parties or there are several interested groups like governments, there are corporations, there are standard organizations, there are users. They keep on giving you the feedback how they have taken up to a product. In case you are manufacturing sanitizer, you are making any products which are related to supply, you take customer surveys. So the customer feedback or customer surveys help you to understand your product better. What are the requirements of my consumers and how I can need to upgrade my products based on standardization requirements. Now, the need of this is as shown here. So there could be opinion of people. Different people have different opinions. Some can see a 9, some can see a 6. So that is how we have to remove that barriers. So the need of standardization is to understand the application. The application generally remains voluntary until and unless regulation comes in. So we in the global trade, what we do, there are regulations as well as there are voluntary requirements, standards like ISO standard, which are voluntary in nature, but they have become regulatory due to many regulations coming in, like the government procurement. Generally in government procurement, there is a tender requirement. In tender requirement, you need certification, you need product standards like BIS, you need CE marking for export purposes, if you're exporting to Europe. And then in India, you are looking at other standards and various bodies, like in food sector, there's FSSAI regulation, Food Safety Authority of India. So that's, again, the regulations are there. these regulations, and there are standards like HACCP, ISO 22000, ISO 9000. These are voluntary standards which have been developed for export-oriented companies and companies who are looking for better output of their products. Now, this is the reason why companies adapt their products to foreign markets. Now, consider you want to access these markets. You have to understand that your product should be able to be conveniently available to them. They must understand your requirements, and they were able to use that requirement, because in case earlier what happened, as we know, when we used to buy some of our relatives who were living in, say, foreign country, they came to India, they brought some electronic goods. Sometimes these electronic goods were not useful for us because they had different compatibility requirements. The plug doesn't suit our electrical plugs. It has a different shape and size. Even the rating of that product, of that charger or any electrical socket was different. Like it in America, that's a 60 hertz, we use 50 hertz. So that was the difference. Now, this caused a barrier for those imported products which we used to get. Now, what is happening across the globe, each manufacturer, whether he's sitting in India, whether he's sitting in Somalia or any other part of the world, he can develop a product based on some guideline, and that product can be sold across the globe to anyone who is accepting that. Now, to understand this, there is a World Trade Organization. Again, this organization deals with all these trade barriers which is existing in our world. Now, World Trade Organization basically looks at all the trades which happen between, there are agreements, there are negotiations, there are bulk manufacturers like China. Like in COVID times, we are facing the heat of the requirements. Now, certainly the pharma sector is looking at the things where there are API availability. And now these are trade barriers because the manufactured good is by some other countries, and there are hides, there are various other, like the raw material is available in some other countries. Now, like we are going through a journey of the auto industry is coming up very fastly. Now, the basic concern area in this is that the initial battery is of lithium. And lithium is available in only pockets of countries, say, only two or three countries have that lithium ore available with them. So they are actually controlling the whole supply chain. Now this creates a trade barrier. Now, basically the consensus here is that we must remove those barriers. Now, this is how standards comes into that place. So that's how the standard freedom of association, no forced labor, no child labor, no discrimination of work enters its barriers. So World Trade Organizations have to deploy these standards. In India, we became a signatory in 1992 after we opened up our economy. So we became members to World Trade Organization. We opened up our economy. So all these type of standards are now mandatory for many other organizations who are making products. So the importance here is we have to provide our people with the mutual understanding documents where we have to follow, because it helps us to improve our productivity. It helps us to measure our activities. We can facilitate communication. We can improve our manufacturing processes, because we are basically facilitating our business interaction. So while doing for standardization, we start with a selection of the standard. We then accept our products, then we diffuse any issues which are not comparable to other standards, then we try to maintain that standard. We codify that standard so that we write in our own language the SOPs, so that our people understand what are the requirements in their own languages, like might be in local languages, and then we prescribe what we do. So we do PDCA, we do Plan, Do, Check, Act to improve our standardization. Now, coming up, this is one thing which we understand, that what is process standardization? Process is the activity which I carry out. So this is the example I have shown. Like we generally do this example while in learning Lean Six Sigma, we generally, the tutor tells the audience, okay, you draw a happy pig. Now it's an exercise. It's draw, everyone will, once starting to draw a happy pig, will draw it, might not be similar. It would be different. Each people might be have observed differently. So a drawing, we are actually trying to, in a manufacturing setup or a service setup, we are trying to have a standard operating procedure where we said we give what to be done, at what stage we give a sequence to each task. Like here, we are given a task like how to draw a letter M, and then how to draw letter W, and then how we draw a letter W, and then this is other sequence. So this sequence and instructions are given to basically make aware the operator or the person who is doing that activity to understand that this is known as process standardization. We use process sheets in our factories, we use in our processes, manufacturing process or IT processes. We have sheets, we have monitoring measurements of those activities, and we try to improve by following these processes. Now, looking at the process standardization, it can be applied to any process, any task, any program. It can be relevant to your own organization. So like you can even have a simple SOP for answering the phone. Like if you are a contact center or a call center, you have a feedback team or a marketing team, how you will answer the phone, how you'll do the payroll, again, how you'll take down client information, and how you'll track your task, what are the things to do, and what are the things to do, daily planning, weekly planning, what calls to make, even how much meetings to attend or meetings to go. So these are all standardized processes. You can use it for your for business purposes, for simple activities, for team meetings, even. So these are all inbuilt to build your quality. Now the quality generally comes through the simple approach in process standardization is the Deming cycle. We call it the PDCA, the plan, do, check, act. So the planning, if you want to do a standardization, first, what is the plan? What are the set of activities you want to standardize? So plan for that activity, then take watch that activity, review that activity. Based on that review, do that activity. Once this is being done, then check whether whatever you have written, they are following the same thing or there is a difference. Whether the operator is actually using the same document which you have drafted or they are doing it on their own, something else. So again, there might be slight tweaking which you do by checking, you observe that thing, and then actions have been taken, the change has to happen. So this is how the approach of PDCA actually is used in process standardization. Now, why are we doing this? Because again, those companies which are already in data, they know that no data is similar. The data is always independent. This sometimes is consistent, sometimes it is not consistent. The content and the format remains same, whatever you want to preach. Like as sir was mentioning, design thinking, that where you are putting your horn, where you are putting ergonomic designs. These, again, these are based on some data standardization that it's, surveys are taken care by the design teams, the R&D teams, or the people who are drafting any standard. They look into all the details, they take, consider every activity, what can go wrong. In case this something can go wrong, they try to remove those barriers. So suppose your friend and went to have different universities, what was the difference there? You study the same way, but you go to say a PEC or say a REC. So there is a difference in that. So the difference is, again, most of the things are common, but there would be slightly some courses would be taught very well in PEC and some of the courses are very good in REC. So again, there would be difference of the person who is teaching them. So again, and the involvement of the faculty and the involvement of the student itself. So there would be different examples. So you can track those data. Values can be put up in a SPC and you can review that. Again, that's the variation you generally learn about in doing data analytics or through the basically process variations you check. So basically the goal is to achieve performance, cost optimization, compliance, security, and risk management. The business objective of any business is these three. These 6 points, 5 points, sorry, have to be looked into to understand why we need standardization. The goal is that these are generally acceptable. So we are looking at performance standards. We are looking at cost optimization. We are looking at compliances at the global level and local level. We are looking at security of our products and processes. And we are looking at overall risk. Is there any threat in our product or process? So this helps us, the organizations, to governed well because they are standardized policies which they define. They try to measure those defined policies, like you have a policy statement or a vision statement, which you try to define. You try to plan and run your business according to your policies, and then you try to monitor those. So you have to enforce whatever you have planned and what are the activities or the outputs or the objectives of the organization are there. And then you update or propose those requirements. So you have examples. There are generally acceptable accounting principles, like in the accounting sector. Then there are standards which are available. Now, one example here is of a business process is McDonald's production process. Now, McDonald's is a global company, and they are selling in hundreds of countries. They are selling the same burger with the same taste, but they are different operators. There are different owners, like the franchisee owners are different, but the process remains the same, the taste remains the same across the globe. So how does that happen? Through standardization. So whatever they do sorting, they do cleaning, they do the filling part, the cutting part, the frozen part, the heat treatment part. All these activities have been time tested. They have utilized the detailed process documentation, which McDonald's team has developed, and this documentation is carried forward across all the franchisees or units who want to open a new franchisee, goes through all the trainings, and all those trainings and this documentation helps to reduce the error or remove the error. In this case, there's no error at all. So this is what standardization of business process can achieve. Now, in manufacturing setups like we are, we have to look into manufacturing in such a way that what are the agreements we have to work? What are the standardization requires? We have to look into our geographical location, where we are in the global arena. Are we supplying only to one state? Are we supplying to different demographies? So again, depending on those demographies and the requirements, we have to look at how we have to standardize our products so that it covers our products in our geographical location at least. And then how we can challenge our competitors in the global arena. Now, for example, we look at LED and LCD manufacturers. Their standardization is very typical for that industry because the standard cover specifications such as screen resolution, size inputs, HDMI ports, USB ports, like internet connectivity, all these are different, but they are continually being improved and modified as we advance our technology. So we need to understand these. And we have to invest in the standardization for these technologies. And we have to advancement of technology as it is happening. It also gives an impact on your standard you are following as a management policy. Now, if you look at the benefits, because it might sound very boring that we have to do a routine job. And again, your employees would always benefit from an established and time-tested process. Like whatever an SOP is there, they have to simply follow that SOP to achieve 100% okay product, good quality product, and at least there would be no variation in that end product. Now, when done well, standardization can decrease your ambiguity and guesswork. Again, there are so many guesswork in a product. It also boosts your productivity because if you know the job, you will be boosting your productivity, increase your employee morale also because there's no non-conformity. When the quality movement actually started, like in India, we talk about one of the pioneer companies in manufacturing was HMT. So HMT watches had a typical manufacturing process. They had a table around which around 15 people used to sit together, and the process used to start there, and there used to be a megaphone at the last stage. What the megaphone was for, like last stage, the quality inspector used to sit there in case he found some fault in the watch. He used to break it down, that watch, using a hammer, and that voice used to be heard by all the people in the factory, tell that this poor quality hurts. So that was the way they thought they can improve quality. Now, that was early 60s, and we were not aware about the globalization then. We were a very closed economy. Now we are open economy. We have to face the challenges of this open economy. We have to improve our clarity about what are the standard requirements, what the customer is looking for, We don't have to do the guesswork because we have the specific knowledge availability now. We have the standard making bodies in India. We have the standards available with us. We can follow those standards to improve our productivity, improve our quality, and train our people so that employee morale is there. And now this can also help us to perfect our customer service. This is what we I meant to say by this, because every ticket we handle or every process we handle in the best way possible can improve our customer service. This is one of the examples. So this is what a standardization sheet looks like. This is a simple example how you can assemble your own, say, a cabinet. This is by IKEA. So they are the pioneers who dealt with self-assembled furniture across the world. Now they have simplified this process so that even anyone buys this product, he can, by seeing these drawings through the various sequence of standardization you can use for your own products, you can develop using this, how they can assemble their own products. Now, again, the standardization, it reduces the ambiguity because the guesswork we spend so much of time, how to put up a mask. Now, this is ambiguity. We have to be safer how we can just put up a mask because it is pointed that way. We know which way it's up. So its arrow is there on the mask itself. The arrow is given so that we know we don't put it wrong, the wrong way. So this, again, it reduces your guesswork. As And another thing is now, what lack of standardization would deal to. So in case any lack of standardization there, we will have so much of things like there is administration, there are paperwork in the organization, there is staff training, there are supervisory checking, following whether the people are following the procedure or not. So we have to minimize the chances that the crucial details get overlooked. Any product which leaves your factory or your process, which is undetected or unchecked, can be a potential non-conformity, can cause a customer complaint, can cause a product recall, and there are a lot of penalties in the global market for any recall. Like any, even the best of the companies across the world are facing the heat in these times if a product goes faulty. Now, looking at standardization, it has to be more functional. It has to look at your functional performance. It has to remove your waste. There is a deviation spiral. What happens in a deviation spiral? The original normal was that there is zero expectancy. What we taught in Z, zero effect, zero defect. We said that there is no defect. We don't accept any defect any at any levels in the organization. Now, if any organization allows a defect to enter its premises and then it leaves your premises or your process, it means it's a deviation spiral. It will not get reduced. It will be increasing at each level. And then the end result would be the customer is not happy with your product and that it will reduce. So the result here is we need to improve our productivity by eliminating and adopting standardization, by eliminating inefficiency. And we have to look at quality control so that we can have right first time quality. That's what the aim of here this slide was. Now eliminating is alternative. Look at alternative procedures, how we can have different people have different types of thought process, and then there is a different, then if three different people have different, their conflicts are inevitable. Now how to avoid that inevitable activity is that we follow a standardized path. And if the standard we talk about productivity, we have to coordinate with each other, so that these, then the SOP must be there, the process plan or process documentation must be there, and there must be evidence of this process being followed. So there is record keeping. So we have to maintain the, so that we reduce our wastage to communicate between the gaps, trying to remove those gaps by talking and by giving training. Again, training can, at one level, it becomes very difficult to provide training to adult. So to providing training, we have to first have an SOPs which define how we have to provide training, how we get involving them, and how we can improve conflicts, remove conflicts. Now, the standardization, again, is for good employee morale. Again, employing morale is that we have to help that employees, we have, once they achieve something, we can show, okay, this good job done by the employee. Anyone can master, and then we can take pride in honing that skill so that lack of creativity can be removed by giving a sense of achievement and pride to all the employees. Now, again, standardization also means better customer satisfaction. So standardized work actually gives you good quality, excellent quality always, better productivity, increased morale. Some of the products, like the most innovative companies in the world, like the 3M, the Google, all they have been using standardization to improve their customer service on a daily basis so that they can improve the remove the barriers of all these activities. Now, looking at the quality part. Now, if you talk about quality, the quality management principles starts with the customer focus. So the quality management system basically is nothing. It's a set of policies and processes and procedures required for planning and executing production development and service. Now, in your core area, you have to look into when you're designing a product or designing a process, you have to look at customer focus, what the customer wants, like the voice of customer as told earlier. Then the leadership team has to sit together. The leadership has to give the environment to the workplace that what are the things which they have to look into, what are the policies or the procedures or the goal of the organization. And based on that inputs, the stakeholder engagement requirements, you get to have a thorough understanding of what are the requirements, what are the customer requirements, and what are the internal requirements you have to deal with. Then you have to engage your people with. What are the engagement levels? How the engagement acts? How you communicate in between your activities? Where in your incoming department talks to the store, your store department talks to the purchase department talks to the suppliers or vendors, so that the quality is inbuilt into your system. And then you have to follow the process approach, which is input, activity, desired output with a feedback loop. Now risk has been added to this. So the process approach is talk about risk-based thinking, which is the 9001 principle, which is talk about risk-based thinking. And then we talk about, we cannot talk in very detail about the 9001, but just to give you a brief, this model is being used for, these are the quality principles which are being used for the 9001 base. So the improvement happens once you understand your process, what are the inputs, how the input has came up, what are the activities you carry out, what are the activities you need to carry out, and what are the outputs, which are the desired output, means what the customer wants. If you achieve those based on the voice of customers, then you have a risk. In case you're not achieving those, these are potential risks. It can cause barriers, trade barriers, in case production loss or fault in your products. You have to improve, continuously focus on improving. And this, again, this has to be reviewed based on decision-making process. Your decision-making process needs to inculcate quality as your base process. You have to inculcate in your people that data has to be taken up on its word. Whatever data is saying, we have to follow the data, the lead, and then have to relationship management. Again, we have to keep along the team. We have to look at to all the stakeholders. There's a concept called context of the organization. We have to understand that context. In that, we understand the need and expectation of interested parties, which are the stakeholders. We identify the needs. Based on those needs, we understand what we have to deliver and we manage. In these times, we talk about 9001 QMS, which is quality management system. Again, this is a certification or a standard which deals with management systems. And then there is for medical devices, then there is typical standard, which is 13485, which is for medical devices and service providers. Then there is a special, like the audience today is more or less people who are into making personal protective equipment related IPC supplies. So there are specifications. These are again known as product standards and regulatory requirements. And then there are product certification and testing requirements, which are regulatory, again, by CDSO, by FSSAI in food sector, by the FDA in the pharma sector, the CDSO by the drug controller, and all those. So there is a difference between a product and a process. Product standard is basically indication of compliance that your product feeds those requirements. And then there's a product standard and there is a specification standard which you follow to meet those requirements. So principles of QMS, it talks about all these things which we talked about. The sequence here is mentioned. You have to follow this sequence to improve your quality journey, to improve, have inbuilt quality in your process and products. Now, what are the benefits of this? The benefit is we have to define and improve our controlling processes. we can reduce our waste, we can prevent mistakes, we can lower our cost by a simple SOP, by a simple process diagram or a process flow chart available with you. You can improve your people to understand they can prevent mistakes, they can lower their cost by have a value stream mapping, or what we call value stream mapping, or a simple flow diagram can help you to facilitate training opportunities. It will help you to engage your staff in a better way. It will help you to setting your organization again in the direction of continual improvement. It will help you to communicate and provide consistent results. So these are one of the things which you have to look at. You have to understand better the customer requirement, how to instill confidence in your people that they are doing the right way, and how we can improve our process and products. Now, the basic steps for any management system, how we can implement all these things. You have to follow the PDCA. The structure is simple, but we have to first design a system. The basic step is designing the system, building the system, deploy the requirements, then control. Try to control after you build. Don't control without deployment. So first, the system needs to be deployed, means the person needs to be given training on what are the process parameters and what are the critical areas he need to monitor on a regular basis. And then define the control parameters. You have control plans for that. Then you measure, you use check sheets, you use various 7QC tools or other things to measure your performance. And then you try to review that. Review can be through analysis, root cause analysis, or CAPA formats, or through through internal audit or management review meetings. You try to review and then try to take action on improvements. So this is how you establish or implement a QMS. And of course, you have to follow the standard. If you are going for a 9001, follow the 9001 clause requirements. There is a documentation requirement. There is a planning requirement. There is a do requirement. You have to follow the 10 clause requirements mentioned in the standard itself. And then you have to learn about that. You have to follow the thing. Then you will implement the things. Now, how this benefits us. So these are, you have process templates. You run and assign a process as checklist. You automate those actions in your apps or through automation. Nowadays, we are using Industry 4.0. We are using all the ERP tools. So we can track our progress of performance and progress, and then we continually improve that. So here you can see here in this, what I want to visualize was they were drafting, making some equipment. So it's automatic. It's been done through not a personal involvement, but the data has to be fed by someone. And there's a monitoring person who's sitting there and monitoring the process, whether this has been done correctly or not. There must be a software there. Someone has designed that software, validated the software. So all this process has to be defined. So each and every activity has to be looked at. Simply, you have daily goals. You have activities of customer satisfaction. You monitor those customer satisfaction goals. And your daily goal has to reflect whether we are meeting those goals or not, what are the differences, what are the changes, then you improve your process. You can keep on changing your process, templates, processes, depending on either are we able to meet our goals, are customer satisfied or dissatisfied. Based on those, we can always improve our document system or our process management system. Now, looking at the conformity assessment and standard in the bigger picture, why we want standards? Because we are living in a global world. It's the world which is full of certification. It is full of industry standards. There are compliance requirements. There are regulatory requirements. So let me just give you a brief idea how we can remove that clutter. Now, simple thing is, as a manufacturer, your first thing is, as a supplier, you can declare your conformity that you're conforming to some standard or thing. Like if you're manufacturing a sanitizer stand, you are conforming to some standard which you say is available and acceptable across the market. So you are giving yourself a report you are generating is declaration of conformity that you follow some particular standard which is might be available to you, might be known to you, or you are made as per the sample provided by the customer. So you have declared your conformity. Then what happens generally as you do in your case of raw material, you ask the supplier to send you a certificate or a calibration or a validation or a verification certificate or an incoming certificate about quality. That's basically a testing done by his PDI report is an input to you. You accept that, or there is a chance you say, no, I don't accept it. I will get it tested through a third party. So you go to a testing lab, get that product tested. And then once you are satisfied, you say, okay, you can supply now. So this is how the general process or supplier declaration of conformity happens. Then it moves towards the independence rigor of the market. Now the independent rigor of the market has been driven through product marking. Like you see here, there are some product marking like UL marking, IEC marking, CE marking, which is very popular for companies which are supplying to the European market. Then there's DIN requirement for German, ASTM requirement for American companies. There's BSI requirement for the UK based exports. Then there are other. In India, there is ISI, which is BIS, Bureau of Indian Standards. Now, these product marking and listing schemes are there in the trade world from last many years. Supplier declaration of conformity is taken, but it's not taken on face value. You need to have product marking and listing in your respective country. If you want to supply to, say Europe or say any other company in Latin America, you need to have product marking listing of your own country of origin. So country of origin certificate is there, and country of origin of certificate, nowadays there is also a requirement. Like I did a lot of workshops for people who are supplying PPs. Now they require so many requirements. So they have to understand that the supplier declaration of conformity has to be taken up. And it's not taken on face value. They have to go for BIS or other ISO standards to showcase that they have their products are equivalent. They are not less than what is expected in those respective countries. Now, there are hazards linked to these because these are protection requirements also. Sometimes there is only the entry barriers, which I talked in briefly in previous slide. There is an entry barrier. So removing those requires that we need to understand these in a detail. Then there is quality management system. Of course, 9001 is one of the base standards, which is the minimum requirement. Earlier, we didn't have any trade barrier. Now, most of the public recruitment or the public buying of by the government is through, they want minimum certification, entry level certification, which is QMS. Then the product marking listing is also there, third party certification, even third parties like NC, BSI or other certifications. Testing by accredited third parties is required, mandatory now. They have to go through them. And then there is conformity assessment accreditation bodies. Like in India, there is Quality Council of India, which is something like they have started developing standards. So there are compliance requirements across the industry. So this is how you look in. So relevance here is because ISO is one of the key bodies which have been developed. This was a global federation developed in 1947. Again, they have developed international standard, which is applicable across various sectors, apart from only the technical economic field, which is again taken by the International Electrotechnical Commission, IEC, and ITU, which is International Telecommunication Unit for only mobile phone manufacturers and telecom equipment manufacturers. They follow these standards. Otherwise, most of the countries or the economies follow the ISO standards. So this is one of the easiest way to have a say, because we need a passport. Apart from a passport, we need a visa also. So this is for exporting ourselves. We need the, ISO and ISO standards act as a passport or a visa for you to enter those economies. Again, if your product is good, then you'll survive the export market. Otherwise, there will be challenges. In without these, you will not be permitted even to enter those economies. Now, ISO being having a large 160 country base, it collaborates with various country standard making bodies and they develop standards for rest of the world. Now, compliance, again, there are compliance requirements. You have to differ here with compliance and standards. Compliance are basic requirements made by regulatory bodies. It also links to standards which are made by in India, like we have BIS, which is leads to standard mark like this, ISI. Then there is ISO, which looks after the ISO framework of 9001, 14,000, 45, all those management standards as well as product standards are available. Then there is in an ecosystem of quality, there is Quality Council of India, which have gone through business excellence standards like Z, which is zero defect, zero effect. Again, WASH scheme in post-COVID times, WASH scheme was mostly subscribed by the organizations which were opening up at that time after the lockdown. So they followed this WASH scheme for maintaining post-COVID operations, how they can maintain their factories and workplaces in a decent manner so that they doesn't have to shut off due to COVID. Then there's specific requirement by the Central Drug Control Organization, which is CDSO, which is the regulatory body in India for all drug related and medical device equipment manufacturers. Those people who are into manufacturing ventilators, manufacturing all these equipment related to medical devices post COVID operations, they need to get approved through CDSCO. Then this World Health Organization, they have standardization for all these requirements. And these you have must seen on the charger of your laptop or a battery backup of your mobile phone, you will find these standards there. These are all country specific requirements. Again, each country has their own standard requirements. So in India, we have ISI, but there are several other standards across the globe. If you want to export to those countries, you have to go for these certifications also. So if you want to export, you have to invest in standardization. Again, this can be voluntary. It can have to be looked into a referential order. You have to look into the details. What are the requirements? What are your goals? You have to according to your goal, define and decide what standards you want to achieve and how you want to achieve. Now, there are compulsory requirements, like for electronic goods in India, there's a compulsory requirement for electronic goods. This is a compulsory registration scheme. It is run through BIS. Then there are licenses for masks and PPEs, which I hope everyone is aware. These are for filter half masks and these coveralls, eye protectors, surgical face masks. Then there are some requirements for medical devices which are covered under CDSCO. You can go to this site and detail, find out your product, whether it comes under CDSCO or not, and what are the requirements for registration for your products. Again, there are testing requirements for hand automatic sanitizer dispenser, as it is an IEC standard requirement 60335. So you have to use this. We can help you to understand these in a better way. There are, again, what are the issues with the sanitizer? To take an example, legal issues are there because we need, for any sanitizer manufacturer, you need to requirement of drug license. So that has to come through the CDSCO or through, if you are able to, you're only a seller, then you have to take a drug license or through a pharmacology. Again, requirement, Department of Pharmacy would look into that. Then hand sanitizer can be used as Ayurvedic or cosmetic. Again, price control has been issued in this. So there's a regulatory requirement. There's a cap on the price you have to keep on a hand rub. Additional compliance requirements by WHO, as well as, again, this is being a essential COVID-19 claim. You have to look into those laboring declaration. Again, quality compliance need to be looked into. It comes under all these rules. So you have to get it through proper channel. You have to, whatever you document or you claim, has to be tested through laboratories. A few days back, there was a claim in the food industry for the honey. You must have heard about that honey claim, which happened that most of the companies in India were found to failing the testing. Some particular test was happening again. So that could cause a lot of blunders. It can cause your export orders to get canceled. It can cause a fury on the social media. It can, because these days it doesn't lie down. Consumers know their rights. They keep on pressing those charges. So we have to look into details as a manufacturer. I must look into all these details. And these are, again, only I put there just to help you out. These are some specific ISO standards which are available freely as part of the ISO pact, which has been released post-COVID. ISO has given all COVID-19 related standards free for industry use. Those who want to use it, those who manufacture similar products, can go to the link and download or read that standard available with them. And then they can check whether they are manufacturing as per the requirements mentioned in the standards, and they can improve their products and production processes based on these standards. This is the link for ISO. You can go to that COVID-19/#. So you can, because they are freely available standards. And in India, BIS is also offering these standards. Now, certification, coming to this part, again, certification is not a mandatory activity. Certification is only after you have developed a system. It's only a checkpoint, whether that you're confirming your requirements as per the certification requirement, you're confirming this requirement as per the standard requirements. This is only a written assurance concerning your product or process, so that the organization which you are selling can keep it as an incoming inspection point. They can verify, okay, you have been certified through a proper audit, and they will not remove their entry level barriers, but they will always monitor that whatever you are finding, what are the findings, what are the improvements you are doing, and you are following the proper structure or not. They can even speak to your certification body which has issued your certificate to check the validation and the verification of that document. So again, this is to check, cross check any. So it also helps you to remove those barriers which have, and helps you to improve your image of the company in case there is competition. Now, similar products have been manufactured by several manufacturers. This is only a differentiator. So this is how the certification, I will say, it's not the product you are looking for. This is only the output of whatever you are doing. And based on that, if you get a certification, it's only a complementary tool. So if you think standardization is the best, in the end, I will just say quality is never an accident. It's always the result of high intention, sincere effort, intelligent direction, skillful execution. It represents the wise choice of many alternatives. So if you had asked people, like Henry Ford said, that if you have asked people what they wanted, they would have said a faster horse. But now we are living in a time, we don't need a faster horse. We need a better and a product which can make us safe, make it reliable. And this is, I will conclude my point here. Now, over to ma'am for further.
Thank you, sir, for your very detailed and insightful presentation. You have covered so many topics, you know, four phase, QFD approach, then standardization requirements, process standardization, what is the goal and how it helps, including performance, cost, optimization, compliances, how to establish and implement QMS, what are the types of conformity assessment and standards. Also, you know, product marking, listing standards, and what are the legal documents required, you know, to move into the global market, how to enter the global space, covering all the important certifications. Thank you so much, sir. Now we open house for all the queries. So the participants, then they can show a raise of hand. So we'll take queries one by one. So if there are any queries, participants, they can show a raise of hand or they can write in the chat box.
Somebody was asking, some question was there in between.
Bajaj. So you want to say something after the presentation?
I think he's not available.
Oh, it seems he's not available.
Yeah. There's one raised hand, ma'am, I believe.
Yes, please go ahead. You can unmute.
Hello. Hello, everyone.
Hello.
Hello.
Sir, I'm Narvinder Rai from Punjab Agro Joseph Limited. Actually, sir, this was good. This was the first experience and we felt better and hope we get Hello.
Hello, yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
This so is not working. Hear you.
Yes, sir. Your question, if you have any question, kindly ask. I think, ma'am, Mr. Anand.
Anand, sir.
Yeah.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening, ji. How are you, Chala, sir?
Fine, sir. Fine, fine. Sir,
first of all, I thank you. Very good presentation.
Thank you.
Mr. Deep, and from your side.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Rather, these were very honest presentations.
Thank you.
So my question is, can we get some format for design section or for designers so that they can follow a standard or they can have all the checks in that?
Sir, as such means ready-made check sheet may not be there, but I can tell you these points that what is the target audience you are having, and accordingly, you know, most of the company I have seen, they make their own checklist. And okay. Then they, I remember I was with working with Rajdoot at that time. They launched one of their motorcycle, and then we did some survey, and we were having in mind at that time Kawasaki was there and then Yamaha was there. So we used to see that what kind of feature they are having and what kind of feature they want to see in our motorcycle. So that sort of benchmarking, that is the one thing which you can use. So that will be helpful.
That only can be if we have some document for reference.
Okay, great.
So that we can make our own document as per our requirements. But if some reference is there.
Okay.
Seven things you have told, but there may be a few other things also in the practice which we may need to take care of.
Yes, maybe. This is what means what I in and around, but I thought that in design thinking means what are the factors which people are deploying whenever they are going for new design. Especially these principles are equally applicable for you know, when you are designing your website or when you are designing your software, when you are designing your product, especially for wherever user interaction is there.
Actually, all those processes, those are got from outside. We take outside help. Right. But designing we have in-house, but we are not, it is not covered under ISO certification also.
Okay.
So, agar ISO certify karane hai, usko no. Okay. Can this be covered automatically?
Yes, sir. May I? Yeah.
Yes, Ankur.
Yes, please.
Yeah. Sir, for this, there is a clause in 8.3 in the new 9001:2015 version. In the 8.3.1 talks about the design input. And then right. 3.2, we talk about the design activity. So the sequence is given there in ISO. Again, the documentation requirement there is defined. How the organization interpret, like design input means voice of customer, identifying, like as sir told you. So design input, you have to define in your own language how you will calculate, collect design input from various activities like your customers or behaviors, or you do a survey. Or what is your expectation about that product? Is the product available to you? Like in generally what happens in companies, like they get some idea from your customer, like Mahindra and Mahindra gives you a job, they give you a drawing, or say they give you a component. Based on that component, you try to inculcate the inputs. That's the development part, but the design part also requires that. So it is given in the standard. Again, if you want to get the thing, you may not get it certified, but you can always use the help of the standard to understand the requirements and accordingly develop your own processes and procedures on that template, sir.
Okay, right. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Any other query, please? Are there any more questions?
Any question, please?
No, nothing in the chat box.
There is feedback link in the chat box. So request if you can, you know, share your feedback by clicking the link. It won't take much time, just 5 questions, and it will take just 5 seconds.
Ramnit, can I take 1 minute? Means I just want to show one slide. Means that just came to me on my mind through this question of Mr. Anand. That generally, you know, we deploy a one technique which we say scamper. Means when we are already having a product, so we see that in that product, what I can do. So what are my challenges which I am having is that either I will look for some other substitute, that how I can substitute something, how I can, you can say, combine two things so that I can make it more economical, or I can adapt to my requirement, or I can modify the current feature, or I can put to some other use, and or I can, you know, eliminate certain things that also can be done, or it may be that I will rearrange the existing features. So this is means conventionally we are using these steps where product is already there, and in the next program when we'll do on value engineering, then probably we'll see one example also that how we can do this also.
Thank you, sir, for your inputs.
Yes, thank you.
And thank you, Dheer sir. Thank you, Chawla sir. And we look forward to our upcoming program. This is on cost reduction techniques. We'll be organizing on 20th of February. Thank you all. Thank you so much for your participation. And we look forward to have you in our further sessions as well. Thank you.
Thank you.
Closing.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you very much.
Yeah, okay, sir. Thank you.